While Mason laughed, Jeff Long interrupted him by saying, "Mason, I don't understand why, but there seems to be something wrong with our communication system." "Like a solar flare from the star over there, but it seems to be coming from this area." Mason, who was still laughing a little, said, "It's probably nothing." Doug Davis came in and said, "It's not just the communications either. The other controls seem to be affected also." Mason quit laughing and asked, "Is it some leftover problem from the meteorites?" "No," said Jeff. "We repaired everything. It seems to be from some kind of electromagnetic radiation." Mason started laughing again and said, "I know. You heard my story, and now you are trying to scare me, right? Huh?" Jeff had a serious look on his face and said, "I just talked to Mason, too, and he doesn't know what's causing the disturbance, either. He said that it's coming from the canyon." Mason smiled and said, My story gets around quickly, doesn't it?" Jeff Long said with concern, "I hate to say this, Mason, but there is a pulsating glow coming over the hill out there." Mason turned and looked through the blue visor shields that were created to shield off radiation, and sure enough, a glow from something was up behind the hill. "Oh, it couldn't be," smiled Mason. "You know, when you guys get bored and want to do something, you really go out and do it. How long did it take to put that light out there?" Mason's crew turned to him and said, at the same time, "We didn't." Mason started to get a little paranoid and said, "Hey, wait a minute. This is just too much. First a man comes to me and claims to be an enemy from the future, then says I'll be exposed to a strange radiation and become a strange flying mutant." Glisso saw that Mason was on the verge of hysterics and said to calm him down, "We don't know that. The glow out there doesn't mean it's radioactive. It could be an unknown space phenomenon. Not only that, but even if it were a radioactive meteorite that contained that strange radiation, you could change history by staying away from it, and that way you would never become the creature the man was talking about. Everything the man told you would never come true." "You're right, Callisto," said Doug Davis, "and I have an idea." "What is that?" asked Mason. "We can send the giant robot out there to test it out. If it is that thing the man was talking about, all we have to do is dispose of it somehow, where we will never have to get in contact with it." Mason looked a little discouraged and said, "I don't know. It sounds like the old nuclear waste monster problem of the 21st century. All coming to life all over again. Only this time, it is in a different form. My robot always seems to blow a fuse at all the wrong times. I guess we could try it. I'll program its radiation analysis." An hour later, after programming his robot through the computer, Mason pressed a button down on a control panel and said, "Here goes nothing." Out on the planet's surface appeared a crack. Two giant sliding doors slid open. Then suddenly a huge 50-foot tall robot came out of the ground on an elevator. The strange the metallic robot with a segmented, blocky body in human form stepped out to examine the strange glowing area. Mason and his crew watched what the robot was doing from the viewing screen that its camera eyes brought back to them. The huge bulky robot kicked up lots of dust, and moved its arms back and forth as it headed toward the canyon. A few minutes passed, and the Colossus was standing on the edge of the cliff. It looked down and revealed to the crew of the space station a silver glowing meteorite that glowed as bright as a spotlight. It was giving off a strange vibration that shook the ground with it, around it. If the planet had an atmosphere, it would be giving off a loud, screaming sound. So that is the thing that is supposed to change my life, huh? Said Mason with a sick feeling in his stomach. The robot began climbing down into the canyon that was brightly lit up. Be careful, ordered Mason. Some of the cliff gave way, and the huge robot slid all the way down into the canyon and blew a few fuses. Damn, shouted Mason. But the robot wasn't badly damaged. Mason ordered it to examine the glowing meteorite. Suddenly, the robot did what Mason didn't want it to do. It opened its chest cavity, picked up the meteorite with its crab pincher hand, and put the entire oddity inside it, then began to climb up the cliff toward the space station. The robot blew some more fuses, making communication with the space station impossible. They could no longer communicate with it. Mason shouted into his communicator, Robot, stop immediately and discharge the meteorite. But the robot couldn't hear his orders from the damaged receiver, and followed its programmed response to head back to the station. Mason started getting a little terrified and shouted into his communicator, Robot, stop, discharge the rock. But it was no use. The robot had made it up over the cliff and was now a quarter of the way toward the space station. But, yeah. I know I shouldn't have sent out that stupid machine, shouted Mason. It always blows fuses when you don't want it to. I think it hates me. What are you going to do? Asked Sergeant Storm. Destroy it, shouted Mason desperately, or become a mutant. The now very frightened Mason ran over to the window like shields and saw the huge robot less than a half a mile from the station. How in the world can you destroy that thing? Asked concerned Sergeant Storm. That thing's steel is the strongest steel known to our science. I know, said Mason, looking determined, but even though it's kryptonite steel that can't be penetrated by the best lasers, its insides can be destroyed. A few minutes later, Captain Laser, a 12-foot giant, ran out onto the planet's surface and pointed his ray gun at the approaching machine. He fired into its chest. But nothing happened. Mason shouted desperately into the communicator, Fire again. Captain Laser did, but it was like shining a flashlight beam on ordinary steel. Mason started sweating profusely and shouted, Aim for its head. Captain Laser did, but still nothing affected the oncoming robot. Suddenly the robot blew a few more fuses, causing it to open its chest cavity and reveal the glowing meteorite, radioactive meteorite. Oh no, shouted a terrified Mason. Captain Laser was right about to fire into the robot's chest cavity and destroy its control center, when suddenly the robot had some tricks up its own sleeve and fired an electric bolt of energy from its head that struck Captain Laser in the helmet, exploding and knocking him on his back. Captain Laser got up and staggered back toward the space station. Mason turned and shouted, "Prepare to put on the force field. I don't think it will stop it, but at least it will slow it down. Storm, prepare the energy balls, the energy bolts. We can't let this get near the station." The robot was only 100 feet from the space station. It went through the force field like a hot knife through butter. Right after that, the robot was being bombarded by energy bolts, putting out its vision and making it blow more fuses. "Hooray!" cheered the station crew, but Mason's little joys of laughter changed to terrified groans of horror when he saw the robot approaching the station blindly. "No!" he screamed in terror. The robot blew some more fuses and started crashing up against the space station. It began to tear through the walls and make the tower-shaped station begin to tilt over on its girder supporters. The glowing meteorite was only 10 feet from him, and the walls of the space station were beginning to crack, causing air to leak out into space. Just when it seemed like the end, the giant robot's control area exploded, causing it to freeze on the spot. The crew of the station got up off the floor and quickly put on their spacesuits, not only to protect them from the lack of air and atmosphere, but to protect themselves from the rays of the strange meteorite. An hour later, and after moving the huge robot back away from the station through a repaired remote control room, the crew began to examine the meteorite. Mason hid behind the lead space station support girder while Callisto and Doug Davis examined the meteorite with Geiger counters and a radiation gun. The meteorite was the size of a rather large watermelon, and so bright that they all had to wear visors. Doug Davis asked Callisto, while adjusting his air valve on his radiation suit. "Well, what do you think of it?" "Creepy, huh?" Callisto had a puzzled look on his green Jupiterian face and said, "It's like nothing I've ever seen before in all my life of studying atomic energy. Not only that, but it seems to go against the laws of physics. Watch." Callisto pulled out a metal bar and tossed it onto the meteorite. The bar became limp and rolled onto the ground. Callisto picked it up and shook it. It appeared to be made out of rubber. "Just like the insides of the robot now. The meteorite has the same characteristics of radioactivity as far as discharging atomic particles, but that's it. It really seems to function more like a power plant or battery," said Callisto as he turned and looked at Mason, who was hiding behind something that he thought would protect him from the meteorite's unknown rays. "You have nothing to fear. This thing isn't going to hurt anyone. All we have to do is hide it in a cave somewhere," said Callisto to the overly cautious Mason. Relieved at that, Mason went back into his space station to rest his nerves. Before he left, Callisto said, Right when he left, Callisto said, "I'd be a fool if I didn't study this thing. I believe I will take a small sample of it." "Do you think you should?" Doug Davis said Cautiously? Why not? Mason doesn't have to know. It's illogical to have such a phobia. Besides, the worst thing he could probably get from this thing is leukemia. Said Callisto, and he pointed the radiation absorber gun down at the meteorite. Callisto pressed the button to the gun, and a blue-colored light of some sort came out of the gun and landed on the meteorite. The beam became silver-colored as it began to beam up the energy of the rock up into the gun. When Callisto turned it off, the meteorite had dimmed considerably and was as bright as a cindering coal. Doug Davis laughed and said, "You only wanted to take a little sample, huh?" A day later, the strange meteorite was mysteriously glowing like it was before Callisto had taken most of its energy. Captain Laser had sealed up in a cave, and Mason walked about extremely pleased that he had changed the cause of history, and wasn't going to mutate into something weird. While Mason played a few games of chess with the computer to keep his mind off the meteorite that was now tucked away in the cavern, his crew were back to doing their everyday work. Callisto walked into the control room and began to go to the food cabinet. Mason got a sick look on his face and asked, "You're not going to cook space beans, are you?" Callisto replied back, "Your ESP must be working today." Mason groaned. "Not those things again. Every time you cook them, the whole station ends up smelling like burned bicycle grease." Callisto put them on the stove and said, "Don't worry. You humans seem to have a fast process of getting used to things you don't like. I can remember how you couldn't stand looking at me because of my Jupiterian looks. Now you think of me as one of the crew, as one of you guys." Mason felt like saying, "You wish," but fought off the urge. A few minutes passed, and Callisto sat down to eat his stinky smelling beans. Mason looked at the black colored beans and said, "Just think, if we didn't dispose of that meteorite, I would have become a strange new form of life, able to endure pain. A Superman of some sort, probably even immortal." Callisto looked at Mason and said, "That's a little hard to believe, don't you think? By the way, who cares about immortality? If you do what you are told by the party, they give you a 10-year shot. You know, we will stay 30 years old forever, and people have been doing so for quite some time now," said Callisto after consuming mass quantities of stinky space beans. Mason sat back and said, "I wonder how it would feel to fly by the powers of my mind. The man said I would fly. But that is a little hard to believe, isn't it?" During the night, while half the crew was asleep, Mr. Long, Callisto, and Sergeant Storm were still at their control stations. Jeff was contacting the traveling space aliens, telling them where to go, like a gas station man giving directions to tourists in an unfamiliar city. Sergeant Storm was playing around with a pen, just passing the boring time away. Jeff got a call from an alien who said on the universal communicator that his spaceship was having problems and that he was thinking of landing on their planet for fueling, refueling, and food. Hearing that brought the spirits of the crew back up, but Sergeant Storm yawned loudly and said, "I believe I'll go to my cabin for some shut-eye." Suddenly, as Storm began to leave the control room, there was a blinding flash of light followed by a shockwave that rattled the ship from the rippling ground. The people who were asleep, like Mason, stirred a little, then fell back to sleep. Storm and Long ran to the window and saw a crashed missile-shaped spaceship lying out in the distance. Seeing that, Jeff and Storm took their Astrocats, a lunar vehicle, and drove to look for survivors. After digging around through the twisted metal, they found the alien who talked about landing a little while ago. He was now dying. The alien told Storm and Long through his own language that he was dying, and that there was nothing they could do for him. The dying alien, who looked human, reached into a spacesuit that was springing air leaks, and handed them a strange object that resembled a large allergy capsule. Something that looked like a giant would take orally. Jeff pulled out his Universal Translator computer and turned it on to see what the alien was trying to tell them. The alien said that the capsule had the power to give immortality, superhuman strength, and the power of telekinesis and telepathy, and that they would be like gods if they ate it of it. The last words he said were, "Use it wisely." Jeff Long and Sergeant Storm couldn't believe that what the spaceman had said. With joy, they raced back to the space station to tell the others. On the way back, Major Matt Mason too, and the rest of his clone crew, rode out to ask Long and Storm if they had found anything. "No," they replied nervously, and they went back to their space stations. An hour later, Mr. Long and Sergeant Storm were talking to Callisto about what the dying alien had told them about the capsule it gave them. Storm smiled with relief and said, "Boy, it sure was good that we didn't tell our clone replicas about it, or there probably wouldn't be enough of this miracle drug to go around." Mr. Long smiled and said, "Gee, Callisto, why don't we just split this capsule into thirds? Then it will just be Storm, you, and me who will have the power of telekinesis and telepathy. Won't it be great?" Callisto had a puzzled look on his face and said, "I don't know. You two are acting very foolish over this thing, which is a natural human response and such, with two such information. But we better analyze some of the powdery stuff before we decide to consume its contents. Who knows, it could be poisonous." "Oh, come on," said Storm. He looked dead serious. "I'm pretty sure it's not deadly." Callisto shook his head slowly from side to side and said, "You have to be logical about these situations. You humans and your emotions seem to get you into trouble quite a lot. You always seem to jump before you leap." Before you look, actually. "When something new and exciting comes along. I, for one, am not going to indulge in this supposed mind power increaser. My Jupiterian mind is superior to most life forms in this universe. And if I really tried, I could probably become telekinetic by the use of my own power, my use of my own, my power. I already have the power of telepathy. Why in the world should I deprive you humans of a drug that can help you when I don't really need it? Do you really feel that way, Callisto? Asked Sergeant Storm. Would Jupiter lie to you? Asked Callisto. Besides, why take something that you practically have? Jeff Long shook Callisto's hand and said, Gee, thanks, Callisto. I'm glad you feel that way. Tomorrow, after we analyze this stuff, Storm and I will become the most superior people on this planet. In the morning, Mason woke up and got ready for breakfast. After shaving and getting dressed, he crawled up the ladder to the control room and was puzzled to see no one around. He was the only one in the space station. Mason looked out through the windshield, like shields of the space station, and saw no one in sight. He was totally alone. Gosh, where is everybody? Asked Mason to himself. Everyone left somewhere without telling me where they were going. Why? Mason walked over to the food cabinet and pressed the breakfast button. Suddenly, his eyes caught the attention of the capsule that the three others had been talking about last night. What is this? He wondered. Mason picked up the capsule and examined it. Mason chuckled, laughed, and said, Gee, I would hate to swallow this horse pill. I wonder who it belongs to. Suddenly, Mason heard a voice shout, Hold it right there, Mason. Mason turned and, to his amazement, saw Callisto holding the radiation gun that contained the strange radiation that was supposed to turn him into a strange, funny mutant. Mason started to laugh a little and said, What is this, Callisto? What is this hostile act? You are one of my best friends on this entire station. I'll stay that way if you give that capsule to me, said Callisto desperately. Mason laughed again, confusion on his face, and said, You're sure acting emotional. I thought Jupiterians didn't have emotions, or at least they didn't show them. Why do you want this capsule so bad in the first place? It's a fountain of youth. It is a fountain of youth. A couple of hours ago, an alien crashed from outer space and told us all about the capsule, saying that contents of the capsule, if ingested, will give you immortality and the power of telekinesis and telepathy. Mason's eyes widened, and he said excitedly, Well, if it can do all that for you, I'll just open it up and make breakfast out of it. Mason started twisting the capsule apart when suddenly Callisto jumped up off the floor, kicked Mason in the face, knocking him up against the wall and causing him to fall to the floor and drop the capsule. Mason got up angrily and said, trying to be calm, Why, you greedy green spaceman, I'll teach you not to knock your majors to the floor. Mason started walking toward Callisto. Callisto stepped back and shouted, Stop right there, Mason. This contains the radiation the man told you about. Mason's heart leaped up into his mouth with terror, making his head throb. He noticed a slight silvery colored glow to the gun, and said in a shocked, toneless way, No, Callisto, no. Yes, Mason, yes. And you better hand that capsule over to me, or I'll test this new radiation out on you and see what it does to you.